What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the last videos of the series, we ran containers, we made use of several images, we saw how we can play around with containers, and we manipulated them with the help of several new commands. And what's interesting about that is that it kind of begs the questions, if all we are doing is running and manipulating a container, then how does this container get shut down? When does a container get shut down? Why does it get shut down? And what happens when it gets shut down? To answer these questions and more, we'll have to dive in detail in the life cycle of a container. So before investigating what happens when a container gets shut down, let's go all the way to the start and figure out what happens when a container is first created. Now, we've learned at this point that to start a new container from an image, we use the docker run command. However, creating a container and starting it up are two separate processes. Therefore, there's two additional commands in addition to docker run that can be used to start a new container. Running these two other commands together will be equivalent to making use of the docker run alone. These commands are docker create and docker start, as you might have guessed. The docker create command is used to create a container out of an image, and the start one is used to start that container. But at this point, you might be a bit curious of what's the distinction between creating a container and starting it. Well, remember the representation we used for the image in which we have a file system snapshot and a startup command. The process of creating a container is where we kind of take the file system and prepare it for use in this newly created container. We're just talking about setting up this file system. To start a container, we execute the startup command that might start the process of like hello world, or in the case of BusyBox, echoing something back to the user. So whatever process is supposed to be executed inside the container is launched. So again, creating a container is about the file system. Starting it is about executing the startup command. With that in mind, let's try to create a container based on the hello world image. When this command is done, it will return with the ID of the container created. With the help of that ID, we can now execute the hello world startup command inside of this container by running docker start followed by the container ID. I'm going to add a little dash a argument here, and we'll talk about what that does in just a second. Okay, when we execute this, the familiar hello from docker message appears as expected. So as a recap, what happened is we kind of prepared the container by getting that file system ready, then after that we executed the primary default startup command with docker start. Now let's try running docker start again, but without the dash a. You'll notice that only the ID of the container is returned, meaning the dash a command is what's going to make docker watch for output from the container and print it out to our terminal. And if you recall, docker run also returns the full output, it watches the container. So it is equivalent to docker create and start with the dash a argument. Now, after this container prints out the hello message, it exits automatically. But just because that container stopped doesn't mean that it's like dead or cannot be used again. We can very easily stop and then start containers again at any point in the future. We can take its ID and then execute docker start and paste that ID. When we do that, you'll notice that it printed the hello message again. If we try to do the same thing with a container based on the BusyBox image, having echo as its startup command, you'll also notice that hello from Geekific was printed in both invocations, which is kind of interesting. You see, what happened was that the primary command we issued when we created the container was issued a second time inside that container. Meaning when you have a container that's already been created, we cannot replace that default command after we start it up. So we cannot do something like docker start followed by the ID and then try to replace the default command. We can't do something like this, as in theory, this would be us trying to replace the default command again, and we can't do that. So once we start a container and let it exit, we can start it back up again, and this is going to reissue the default command that was used when the container was first created. Now it might seem like going over all this lifecycle stuff is kind of unimportant, but trust me, having a solid understanding of the lifecycle of a container is going to be incredibly useful, especially when it comes down to figuring out how to troubleshoot these things and debug a running container. Alright, you can now see that we currently have all these containers, which are essentially just taking space on our computer. So it might be useful to try to entirely delete them and not just leave them in the exited state. To do that, we can run docker container prune, and this will delete all your stopped containers. Notice that the command tells you this when you issue it, and it also asks for a verification check. This command will also tell us how much space has been reclaimed by deleting these resources. And if we do docker ps --all, we'll see that no more containers can be found anymore. You can do the same with images by making use of docker image prune, and this will delete all dangling images, meaning all unused images that have no name and tag. Another important thing we can do with stopped containers is retrieve their logs. to check how let's run a container based on the busybox image having echo as its startup command. That container will print out the message we want and exit immediately. So at some point we might want to go back to that stopped container and get all the logs that have been emitted inside of it. To do so, we can run docker logs followed by the container ID, and we'll see that when the container was running, it printed out the string hello from Geekific. And just to be clear, by running docker logs, we're not rerunning or restarting the container, we're just getting a record of all the logs that have been emitted from that container. Additionally, the logs command is something that we're going to be using quite a bit, as it's a really good way to inspect a container and see what went on inside it. Okay, after going through all of this lifecycle stuff, we managed to answer a couple of our initial questions, but not all of them. We still haven't figured out how to manually stop a running container. To answer this question, let's run a container having pingyoutube.com as its startup command. If you recall our previous video, this container will not exit automatically, it will keep running. So, how do we stop this container? Well, to stop a container that seems to be running on its own, we can issue either the docker stop command or the docker kill command. Both are going to stop the running container. But the difference between them is that docker stop will send a message to the process inside the container telling it to shut down on its own. So we are giving that process a little bit of time to shut itself down and do a little bit of cleanup. On the other hand, the docker kill command issues a kill signal to the primary running process inside that container. Kill essentially means that it must shut down right now and it doesn't get to do any additional work. So ideally, always stop a container with a docker stop command to give the running process inside it a bit of time to shut itself down. Otherwise, if it feels like the container has locked up and is not responding to the docker stop command, then we could use a docker kill instead. Also, you should know that after you issue a docker stop, if the container does not automatically stop in 10 seconds, then docker is going to automatically fall back to issuing the docker kill command. So let's try to use these commands on the container we have, and issue docker stop followed by the ID of the container. In this case, we're going to end up waiting 10 seconds before the container stops. You see, it turns out that the ping command does not properly respond to a stop message, so after we waited 10 seconds, a kill signal was sent to the ping command, forcing it to stop. Okay, let's run that container again and try to stop it with the help of the docker kill command. This time, you're going to see that it instantly stopped, no grace periods. That's it. These are the two commands that we're going to use for closing containers that are running. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.